The following film contains scenes that some viewers may find disturbing. This film contains strong language and violence. Viewer discretion is advised.
After years of fighting in Vietnam and the drafting of young men to serve in the military, many in America believe it's time to end the war. Anti-war protests around America begin with more and more frequency, and the college students become the focus of these protests. President Nixon won the presidency by campaigning to end the war in Vietnam. On April 30, 1970, his announcement of the Cambodian incursion shocks and angers many in the United States. A new surge of anti-war protests began all around the United States. Kent State would become one of the many protesting campuses. Protests on the Kent State campus started on May 1, 1970, would begin 4 days of campus unrest that would spiral into absolute chaos, ending with the deaths of 4 students and the wounding of 9 others when the Ohio National Guard opens fire on unarmed protesting students. What really happened here on the Kent State campus? Using hundreds of photos, several 8mm films, and interviews with the student witnesses, we will follow the events on Kent State from May 1st through May 4th, 1970. Kent State, the real story. The war in Vietnam had already been going on for several years, and the American public was growing tired with what seemed like an endless war. Many Americans were affected by the war and the draft. This included many students at Kent State.
I would say that we started getting different speakers in because of the war, and I understood that. I had a brother that graduated from college and got his draft papers the week before his exams. That was pretty tough for him.
I think the politics of the students were pretty much apolitical. Most of the kids were there to get an education or to avoid the draft or at least postpone it. There were a few radicals, I would say. We called them radicals at the time, and I would say that there's probably less than 24 who were more or less politically active. The rest of the people always would stop and be entertained by them. They had to be fairly out there in order to draw the crowd that they needed so that they could espouse what they were believing in at the time. But I think basically it was a pretty apolitical time.
Protests on the Kent State campus are becoming more and more frequent, but still only have a small following. In the fall of 1968, the Black United Students, or BUS, and supporting students protested the arrival of the Oakland, California Police Department on campus with a sit-in. With a possibility of discipline for their actions, the students continue to protest with a walk-off campus rally. In the spring of 1969, students attempt to enter the Kent State University Administration's building with a list of demands they want enacted. This resulted in several of the students being arrested. Disciplinary hearings were set up for those individuals involved in the administration building protests. These hearings were interrupted when student protesters attempted to take over the music and speech building, the location of the hearings. This led to the arrests of over 60 students for their actions on campus. Nearing the summer of 1969, more anti-war protests take place with a focus of removing Reserve Officer Training Corps, or ROTC, from the campus. When the students return to the campus in the fall of 1969, the protests will begin to grow in size and move out into the streets of Kent, Ohio.
It wasn't a huge protest as much as it was a to let people know that there was a voice against the war. It wasn't like so strong that, you know, some of the other schools were very violent and very strong. This was a very organized, well thought out plan. There's lots of pictures of kids making posters and getting ready to go out there and walk through campus and through downtown. And it was just a very neat, orderly thing without a lot of anger involved. It was, hey, we want you to know that we're kids. We don't think this is a thing that anybody should be doing right now. There shouldn't be a war in Vietnam. And
During these protests in 1969 in downtown Kent, Ohio, Alison Krauss is seen out front holding a protest banner. Peaceful protests continue in 1969 and into 1970 when Jerry Rubin arrives on campus.
The atmosphere when Jerry Rubin stopped at Kent was very lighthearted. They had a rock band, I think it was called Gildersleeve, was playing out there. And it was a bit of theater on Jerry's part. A few of the campus radicals were passing out leaflets, and there was one guy that looked like Fidel Castro.
Jerry Rubin had some pretty radical ideas for those listening.
And maybe they might have had 100, 120 people at their various assemblies. My recollection is our enrollment was 20,000, so I don't believe that would could be capitalized as a majority of the students were interested. For example, one time I was at a rally where Mr. Rubin was there, and I had an occasion to use the restroom when he was there. And inside the restroom, he asked me if I was listening to his message, whereupon he said, you know, if you believe in this, you have to believe in it enough to be able to kill your own parents. Well, I told him where to shove it. I mean, I would assume that 99.9% of all the students reacted in that fashion.
The protest continues with various demands and the removal of the ROTC from Kent State University. On April 30th, 1970, Richard Nixon goes on national television to announce that U.S. troops will enter Cambodia to attack Vietnamese safe havens, expanding the Vietnam War. Known as the Cambodia incursion, this sparks outrage with many Americans. Howard Ruffner was on campus all weekend and photographed the events taking place.
But the Nixon thing was so low-key in the sense that students don't have TVs. They weren't going to spend their time listening to news on the radio. That's where they listen to music. And it was a low-key event. And you could tell it was a low-key event because when the history students had their protest the next day, 600 people, maybe 700 people showed up. I mean, it wasn't a very big rally. We're talking about a school with a population of 18,000 students, and wow, 500 people thought the Nixon thing was a big deal. Or at least they thought they would had nothing else to do. They'd go down and listen to the history students talk about what Nixon did and how he had fractured and broken the Constitution, and we should no longer trust him. It was a choreographed event in the sense that they made sure there were history students there. They made sure that there was a female there. They made sure that there was a black person there. And they made sure that there was somebody there who was against what they were doing. But I think it was just a very, very well-rehearsed thing. Not that that's bad, because they wanted to put a point across about the importance of the Constitution and how the president was just not following constitutional norms. And as the lunch period was coming to an end, which would be around 1 o'clock, people started leaving. And they knew they couldn't say, come back tomorrow, like a regular university, because Kent's a commuter school and a lot of kids go home. So they, Steve Sharoff said, or one of them said, it might not have been Steve, you know, let's continue this discussion on Monday at noon, and we'll talk more about what Nixon did and how it's wrong, and we will continue this discussion at noon, knowing that no one else is going to be around the weekend or anywhere. So that's what they did. They thought they could just continue the whole thing on Monday at noon.
After the history students protest the burying of the Constitution, the Black United Students, known as BUS, held a meeting with its members. Speakers urged its members to avoid demonstrations and protests on campus, fearing that they would be accused of starting the unrest. The evening of May 1st was one of the first warm nights of spring. The bars in town were filled, but around 11 p.m., the mood changed. Store windows were broken, graffiti, and a fire was set in the middle of the street. Police in riot gear using tear gas finally ended the disturbance at approximately 2:30 a.m. when most of the students returned to campus. Mayor Leroy Satram, worried about the events, called the governor's office inquiring about the National Guard. On May 2nd, Mayor Satram hears of rumors of radicals heading for Kent. Near the end of the day, he declares a civil emergency and officially requests the Ohio National Guard. Ohio Governor James Rhodes orders the National Guard from the trucking strike in Akron to Kent, Ohio. Late in the afternoon of May 2nd, rumors begin to spread on campus that something is about to happen at the ROTC building.
And as it got darker, people just migrated toward the ROTC building. And I don't think it was like, it wasn't a line of people protesting. It was like from different parts of the campus, people started migrating toward the ROTC building, either because they heard something might happen there, or maybe because they were the ones who were going to do something there. But it was not the kind of thing that was, maybe depending on where you were standing, but where I was, I didn't see a mass movement of any kind. It just kind of happened.
At roughly 7:45 p.m., a crowd near the Victory Bell begins to chant, "Down with ROTC." They then start marching around the campus, gathering more students. At approximately 8:30, the crowd returns to the ROTC building. They begin breaking windows with rocks and throwing flares inside to ignite the structure. No police are in sight or attempting to stop what is currently happening. At 8:50, the fire department arrives, but immediately trouble begins. The hoses are slashed with knives and machetes. Some in the crowd begin throwing rocks at the firemen. By 9:15, without police protection and being harassed, the fire department leaves the area, believing the fire is out. Moments later, local police arrive. They find that the fire department has gone, but the crowd of students remain. Police use tear gas to break up the crowd of protesters. Angered by the arrival of the police, the crowd tears down a fence between the commons and the tennis court. They break the windows of the information center and set fire to the archery equipment shed. Shortly after 10 p.m., the fire department, escorted by police, returned to the ROTC building, now fully in flames. It is during this time that the Ohio National Guard arrives in the city of Kent and on the campus of Kent State University. Generals Robert Canterbury and Sylvester Del Corso meet with Mayor Satram. Hearing that the fire hoses were cut earlier in the night, Del Corso issues the command to shoot any rioter that cuts a fire hose. The Ohio National Guardsmen move out and take up strategic points to keep students from entering the town of Kent and from moving around the campus. Rumors that the library and that Kent State President White's home were to be set on fire only added more restrictions on movement. The National Guard formed a skirmish line and began moving students from the area. Using bullhorns, they ordered the students to return to their dorms or face arrest. One student was injured by a bayonet with a cut to his face and leg. By 11:55 p.m., it appears that the Ohio National Guard has everything under control on the campus and in Kent. The fire department continues to fight the fire at the ROTC building, but it is too late. The building is a total loss. Sunday morning, May 3rd, 1970, the ROTC building on Kent State campus has been burned to the ground, a pile of ashes. Ohio Governor James Rhodes, General Sylvester Del Corso, Mayor Leroy Satram, along with others, inspect the damage. The National Guardsmen take up strategic positions around the area. Rhodes, Del Corso, Satram, and others later hold a press conference at the firehouse.
Governor, what size organization do you think that you're up against here at the university?
Well, I think that we're up against the strongest, well-trained, militant, revolutionary group that has ever assembled in America. And there has to be some way of getting some subsidy for these people to fight, and these people just move from one campus to the other and terrorize a community. They're worse than the brown shirt and the communist element, and also the night riders and the vigilantes. They're the worst type of people that we harbor in America, and I want to say that they're not going to take over a campus. That any person throwing a rock, brick, or stone at a law enforcement agency or high, a sheriff, policeman, highway patrol, national guard, becomes a felony. We are going to ask for an injunction, ask the attorney general here shortly, which is equivalent to a state of emergency, and it will give some additional authority to some of the people that's affiliated with the state of Ohio. There's no place, there's no sanctuary, no place off limits. And we're going to disperse crowds. We're going to help the mayor enforce the curfew.
When will this injunction go into effect?
Well, we're all trying to work on it right now.
Elaborate on what this injunction is going to do that you're asking the attorney general to do.
Well, the injunction will give some more police powers to people we want to hear and be some plainclothes people, too. It's when we're going to employ every weapon possible. These people causing the trouble are not all students at Kent State University. The members of the faculty inciting riot, they're just as guilty as the students carrying out the acts. What's that?
Will there be classes?
As far as I'm concerned, keep the university open. We'll keep it open for you. And I'll say 99% plus of the students at Kent State want it open. They're here for an education. General Del Corso.
As the governor mentioned, it was very fortunate that we had troops assembled here for another mission, and at the request of the mayor of Kent, we moved our forces in here, and we were able to put a stop to this very quickly and contain the fire to the one building, provide security for the fire department, which was initially pelted by rocks. The fire hose were cut, and they were forced to evacuate the campus because of this, because they didn't have enough protection. And shortly after we arrived, which was less than half an hour or so later, security was put on the truck by armed troops, and they moved back in and contained the fire to the one building. And we have sufficient force in the area. We will apply whatever degree of force is necessary to provide protection for the lives of our citizens and his property.
The National Guard given our full support. Anything that's necessary, like the Ohio law said, use any force that's necessary. To the point of shooting, we don't want to get into that, but the law says that we can't if it's necessary.
The atmosphere has been set by political and military leaders at the press conference. By midday on the Kent campus, it is almost a carnival atmosphere with students and National Guardsmen interacting and completely relaxed.
Regarding the presence of the Guard and the attitude toward the students, toward the Guard and vice versa, it was very unreal because for students who were supposed to be against the war and against the military, everybody was very friendly. Matter of fact, friendly and nonchalant. I mean, but part of that came from parents, I believe, because I've heard some students talk about it, the fact that, because I would say, well, why the heck would your parents bring you back to a school that a building burned down and there's 2,000 National Guard on campus? Oh, they think it's safe now. So because the Guard is there, it's a safe place for my student to go because all the bad guys are gone and the student and the National Guard is going to take care of everybody. So I think there's a kind of like misdirected or misguided appearance of the National Guard is your best friend. They've taken care of all the bad guys and, you know, you'll be safe on school now. And I feel that's, now that they're there, that's safer. And I think that's why you don't see, that's why there's pictures of the students playing in the Jeeps with the National Guard or just walking by and having conversations and talking to them. Everybody thought, well, the National Guard's here, I'm safe. Remembering that it's a commuter school and no one has much information about what actually happened the night before for real. And students just came back to school and thinking that things would be normal.
On the afternoon of May 3rd, Allison Krause placed a flower in the barrel of a National Guardsman's rifle. Her comment to him, flowers are better than bullets. With curfew time coming, people began to head back home, but traffic jams slowed the process.
The question about what happened Sunday night that caused everything to go to chaos is a really powerful question, because it talks to one of the main problems at the university at the time, and that was that there was no communication. The ROTC building burned down, and you have a few people walking around with armbands now, handing out leaflets. But what was happening was people were getting to be told that there's curfews on campus, curfews off campus. And what people forget is we didn't have cell phones, we didn't have fax machines, we didn't have walkie-talkies, and there wasn't much news to listen to. And no one really knew what was happening because they were getting information from different sources. A friend would come in off the street and say, here's what I heard. You know, somebody else would say, here's what I heard. And, oh, I got a bulletin that says we're supposed to have a curfew tonight. And then somebody says, well, the curfew's been changed. I mean, that was happening all night long. And all the students really wanted, especially the students who finally found a way to get off campus and get down to Water Street in the middle of the intersection, all they wanted was a human being from the school, the administration, to say, here's what's going on. The administration failed. They balked. They decided that the National Guard was in control, and pretty much that's evident. If you look at the photographs where the administration building is, there's not a policeman from Kent State out front. There's two National Guard out there guarding who goes in and goes out. They're not talking about administrators. So I think the administration just flat out failed. They just said, you know what, it's out of our hands, and let it go. And no one really had clear communication. I mean, at the Water Street intersection, which I was part of, I was at, students were told there was one curfew, and then when the students got a little more demanding about wanting to hear somebody, another curfew was announced saying, hey, guess what? You've got 5 minutes to disperse this area. And they meant that.
When I got back from New Jersey, my two roommates told me about burning the ROTC building down. I told them, well, let's go up on campus. And they go, well, you know, you can't do that. Well, I happen to have a Ohio National Guard press pass from the Boardman News that my father owned. And I encouraged my two roommates to come with me to go onto campus. Well, as we got out of our apartment, we had some guy, there was a helicopter above our apartment, was shining his light down, and, you know, we're off campus, you know, they don't have any authority over us. We sort of laughed it off, and we went up to campus, parked our car at Kent Roosevelt, I believe it's a high school, and walked across campus somewhere by what I remember as the education building. And I said to my two roommates, no problem, we'll get right past this, I'll just flash my press card. Well, we probably got two or three steps on campus and were ordered to leave, whereupon I say, oh, no, no, here, I have my pass. That didn't matter too much. They physically picked us up and removed us from campus, and we went back to our apartment and went to the swimming pool area, possibly had a few drinks, watching the helicopters fly over us.
At 11 p.m., the Ohio National Guard and police used tear gas to break up the crowd in the city. Chaos ensues. Arrests are made, and a number of protesters are injured by bayonets as they run back towards the campus. Many take refuge in any building they can find and wait until Monday morning. Monday, May 4th, 1970. Many students have returned to the campus completely unaware of the events of the past few days. What they find is their campus filled with Ohio National Guard troops. Generals Del Corso and Canterbury, Mayor Satram, Kent State President Robert White, and others meet at the firehouse again to discuss how to handle the situation. Kent State President White has just returned to the campus from a vacation in Iowa. The facts of this meeting are still in dispute, but what is known is no injunction was in place. There was no martial law, and the Ohio National Guard did not have the authority to take control. The discussion turns to opinion, and it is believed the Ohio National Guard has full control. Flyers were immediately distributed around the campus, banning gatherings. WKSU begins broadcasting that all outdoor demonstrations and gatherings are banned. On Friday, May 1st, the history students had planned a noon rally at the Victory Bell on the Commons on Monday, May 4th.
Monday, May 4th, the day was going pretty much as normal, except the Guard were marching around in formation, which made things a little unusual. I took a photograph of that, and students are walking to class one way, the Guard's in formation walking the other way. There was no animosity expressed. Business as usual. There had been trouble over the weekend, but 99% of the people there had nothing to do with it and had only heard about it like I had. I certainly knew that there was a rally scheduled for noon on Monday, May 4th, and that it had been deemed as an unlawful assembly.
I went over to Taylor Hall to a class and walked in. I think I talked to Howard Ruffner, trying to remember if John Darnell was there. I don't remember, but I do know Howard was there. Well, it was a pretty busy time of the day because kids were getting out of class, kids were going to lunch, people were doing a lot of things that they normally do on a campus, and that area gets pretty busy because you've got dorms to the other one side of it, you've got Taylor Hall in the middle, you've got the Commons area, and Blanket Hill, and then you go on down and there's walkways that go on to the other buildings, and then the student center and what have you on that area. So it was a very busy pass-through place that kids walked all the time. And so it was nothing to see, 100 kids just walk through there at a time of day that this all was taking place. So that was not unusual. But I did hear that there was a protest. I was in Taylor Hall at the time. And I believe that John Filer was in there loading up his camera. In those days we had film. And I had gone in and taken a couple rolls of film and put in my camera as well. So I started taking pictures. And for some reason, I felt uneasy. And a lot of students were walking through there. I knew there was a protest going to happen. And honestly, I can't tell you that there were that many students there for the protest. There were a good few handfuls of students. I don't know if it was 30, I don't know if it was 50, but it couldn't have been a whole lot of students because most of the students were walking through there. Now, as they were walking through, they stopped because the guards were coming up on that area, and then some of the protesters had, you could tell they were protesting. So a lot of this was stop and watch, stop and listen, stop and look, let's see what's going on.
And I got up early and I went to the Stater office. And we talked about the fact that we knew that there was supposed to be a rally there today at noon because one of the people from the history group said there would be a rally today. And that's when the Stater office got a phone call from Life magazine in Chicago, and they gave me the call because they knew I was a photographer who had been around all weekend. I was actually the only photographer who was around all weekend in the sense taking pictures. And I talked to them and they asked if I would take some photographs of anything that took place that day, and I said I would. And previously to this, I had actually met with Major Jones, who's one of the major players in this whole thing, for who knows why, but he was a major player. And I had a signed press pass from him. And maybe I did that because I was in the service. I felt, you know what? Press pass isn't going to hurt me here, because if I have to go around and do things, it gives you a license, it gives you a way to be into things. And so I had his press pass, and they, Life magazine, asked me to take some pictures that morning, and anything that happened, and I agreed to do that.
Well, my view is that sometime Sunday night, I believe, President White said that we could not gather. It was not permitted. I believe he had a conversation with Governor Rhodes, Portage County prosecutor by the name of Ronald Kane, both of whom, by the way, were up for re-election, and they declared, in effect, martial law. All the people that I knew, all my friends, we were just like regular students. We thought, well, you know, you don't have a right to do this. We're paying tuition to be at Kent State, and you can't kick us off our own campus. So I had a class about 10 o'clock. I believe it was called off about 10:30 because it was at Taylor Hall and we had martial law. And so I had my camera with me because it was a journalism class, and I immediately went out, and as many of the students did, we went out to see what they were going to do, how they were going to disperse this, and it was sort of like a curiosity thing. Let's see what's going to happen here at the Commons.
Monday morning, a normal school day, students are being dropped off by their parents. Some may be going directly to class, some may be going to their dorm to get their books and change something or whatever. It's a normal class time, okay, a class time event. People are going to cross. You've got 18,000 students going from dorms to administration buildings to teaching buildings, and they all need to be someplace. And some wanted to heard about the rally, so some were going to stop on the Commons where the victory bell was. And they kind of separated themselves out. By this point in time, after the weekend, there was a group of kids who were definitely quite upset that the National Guard had taken over the campus. The National Guard seemed to be running the show. The administration had kind of set back and said, we're out of this. And so I would say the main core of that group would be between 300 and 600 people on the closest to the guard down by the victory bell. When I say close to the guard, I mean 300 yards. And then behind them, that group were other students who were kind of like watching because they saw an angry group and then they saw the National Guard still pretty far away. And they were the watchers. They were just kind of like hanging out, and some of the students had books in their hands. And at this point in time, I had decided I'm going to go down and take pictures. So I took pictures as I went down the hill from Taylor Hall to where the guard were. I went straight down the hill, and then I went to my left to the sidewalk that goes down between Taylor and Johnson Hall down to the student union at the time. And I actually showed my press pass to the guard and got behind their line. So I was able to do some photography before I got there and after I got behind the National Guard.
At approximately 11:30, General Canterbury returns to the campus after the meeting with other officials at the Kent Firehouse, believing the Ohio National Guard is in full control. He sees the students gathering on the commons but does not perceive any threat, since it's a small group of students that have gathered. As classes begin to let out for the lunch hour and not fully understanding the student movements, Canterbury suddenly becomes concerned as with each minute that passes, more and more students are arriving on the commons. This photo by Howard Ruffner has two students that just stopped to see what was happening, Sandra Sandy Scheuer and William Schroeder. Howard's next photo has Jeff Miller, Marianne Vecchio, Steve Sharoff, and Dean Kaler. On Friday, the history students had called for the Monday, May 4th rally, but now everyone was just watching and waiting.
It was decided that there would be no speakers at this rally, that there would be that nobody wanted to be arrested, so there wasn't going to be any forerunner or front man to it, but I believe that most of the people that were stopping by at noon were simply there to see what the small group down in front of the victory bell were going to pull off.
At approximately 11:45, Canterbury, concerned that the number of students had grown so rapidly, holds a meeting to discuss dispersing the students from the area.
There's a curfew on this campus, there's no rallies permitted, and you're not going to have a rally here. And by now the crowd behind the initial crowd is a lot of students. I mean, I guess why I talk about 1,000 students or whatever, but as you went up further up the hill, there are more students, and the students that were further up the hill were less engaged. The further up the hill you went, the less politically engaged the students were. You know, you go from being engaged to watching closely to being just an observer to being somebody, I'll hang around for a few minutes and I got to go to class. The balcony at Taylor Hall was filled with people who are just watching. This is a singled out crowd, the crowd at the bell. There was another crowd of 500 or 600 people behind the ropes at the ROTC building at the other end of the area. And there was one by the tennis court, and there was one on the other side. But the only crowd singled out for being a rally was the crowd in front of the Victory Bell.
William McGuire's photo of students near the Victory Bell captures Allison Krauss walking in the area. Terry Norman is photographed watching and photographing students near the Victory Bell.
Terry Norman was a part-time Kent State student who was taking photographs of demonstrators for both the campus police and the FBI. And he came to the rally with his camera to take photographs, and he had a concealed gun. As far as we know, he's the only person, non-guardsman, or non-law enforcement, who was carrying a gun that day.
At roughly 11:48, someone starts ringing the Victory Bell and the students begin chanting in protest. Within 1 minute, campus police officer Rice begins using a bullhorn to tell students to leave the area immediately. He can barely be heard over the chanting of the students.
I decided to go out and try to find a position where I could see the guard and see the students in front of the Victory Bell. Had a couple of Nikons around my neck, telephoto lens, wide-angle lens. Around noon, the radical folk down in front of the Victory Bell got a little more boisterous and took the notice of the guard. The guard, I believe it was actually not the guard, but the sheriff. It was a police presence of some sort that got out the bullhorn and explained to us that it was an illegal assembly and we must disperse, and nobody really took much heed.
At roughly 11:52, since the students have not moved, Officer Rice gets into a Jeep with 3 National Guardsmen. They begin driving out towards the students at the Victory Bell and make loops around the commons. The students chant louder, many making gestures towards Rice and the National Guardsmen, and finally, someone throws a rock towards the Jeep. After 5 minutes of the Jeep driving around the commons and seeing that students were not leaving the area and only getting louder, Major Harry Jones of the Ohio National Guard runs out onto the commons to have the Jeep returned back to the ROTC area. Orders are given to use chemical agents to get the students to move from the area around the Victory Bell. And at approximately 11:57, Major Jones moves forward with several National Guardsmen to deploy tear gas. They begin deploying the gas, and many of the students begin running from the area. Many of these students had just stopped to watch what was happening as they were walking through campus and were not part of the protest. The wind reduces the effectiveness of the tear gas, and some students stop on Blanket Hill near Taylor Hall to watch and see what will happen next. Angered that the Ohio National Guard is on campus making the rules and that their peaceful protest has been broken up with the use of tear gas, other students run back into the commons. They pick up the smoking tear gas containers and throw them back at the National Guardsmen. This goes on for a few minutes, and now more students join in throwing the tear gas back at the National Guard. It is obvious to General Canterbury that the students are not going to leave the area. While the tear gas is being deployed, more Ohio National Guard troops move into position and prepare to move the students from the area. There is a very brief pause in the deployment of tear gas as the students watch the newly arriving troops getting their gas masks on. Once the troops were ready, General Canterbury gives the orders to move out and push the students from the area. On the left flank is Charlie Company 145th Infantry. In command is Major Jones. In the center is G Group 107th Armored Cavalry Regiment. In command, Lieutenant Colonel Fassinger. And on the right is Alpha Company 145th Infantry with General Canterbury. Just before starting to move into the commons, the National Guard begin deploying tear gas again on the watching students. Terry Norman is spotted wearing a gas mask as he takes photos of students on the commons.
But something made me feel very uncomfortable when the guards got marching up towards the top of the hill next to Taylor Hall. And my dorm was right there. And I thought, you know, I think I'll run over to the dorm and go up to third story. And on the corner of the dorms, we had study halls. In those days, we had a corner study hall. So I ran up to third story, and in the study hall, we had big glass windows, and then we had windows that you could roll out. So what I did was I rolled the one window out, I took the screen out, and I sat out from the window, and I put my legs out the window and hung onto the window, and I started taking pictures.
For some reason, my instincts told me to hang around the National Guard, so my recollection is a gentleman by the name of Ike Pappas from CBS started to follow the guardsmen as they advanced into the commons and up the hill. And with my press pass, I followed right behind him. I can't find myself in any pictures of that, but that is what I did.
More tear gas was fired, and all the observers, which is 99% of the people there, decided they better get out of there. They didn't want to breathe the gas. A lot of them went through Taylor Hall, stopped in the bathroom, wiped the tear gas out of their eyes, maybe picked up a towel or a paper towel to, and went out the backside of Taylor Hall and gathered on the, it's kind of a patio surrounding the building on the backside near the Don Drum sculpture.
Being behind the National Guard was a very weird experience because I thought, well, you know, I'm on assignment for Life magazine, that's a big deal. I can't be taking one side or the other. I can't just be taking the student side or the National Guard side. They've asked me to take events and take pictures of the whole event. So I'm down there now and I'm taking pictures of, you know, guard lining up, guard with their gas masks on already, also their bayonets still purchased on top of their M1s. And thinking that, you know, I didn't think much was going to happen. I mean, just, you know, because it's lunchtime and people are still wandering back and forth. And when it's lunchtime, sure, there are classes going on, but most of the students are deciding what I'm going to have for lunch, or they're going to class, meet somebody in a dorm, whatever. And when they started marching up the hill, it was very unreal. I had a 200 millimeter lens on my camera, so I didn't have to get very close. I was fairly far back from the real action. And I could follow the guard as they went up, and I thought, it's unreal. They're actually moving these students up the hill. And the thought in my mind was, where are they going to go? And they went on both sides, and I met John Philo, and we were both talking for a few minutes before we decided where else to go, because the guard had already dispersed and started going down on both sides of Taylor Hall. And he asked if he could borrow a lens, and I said, I have a short little lens, you can use a little zoom. And he took that, and he said, I'm going to go up this side. I said, well, I'll go up this side.
As the National Guard begin to move into the commons, students can be seen running away between Taylor Hall and Prentice Hall. Students clear the commons as the National Guard moves forward. Some of the tear gas canisters are thrown back at the troops, and a few students have begun to throw rocks at the line of National Guardsmen. At approximately 12:02 p.m., the Ohio National Guard begin moving from the area of the ROTC building into the commons. C Company moved forward to take a position between Taylor Hall and Prentice Hall to keep the students from returning to the commons. G Group and A Company's objective was to move the students off Blanket Hill between Taylor Hall and Johnson Hall. As C Company nears the tree line, they begin to fire tear gas back towards the students following them from the tennis court area. G Group and A Company continue to fire tear gas as they move toward Blanket Hill. C Company also encounters a student that was ringing the victory bell and then threw a rock at them in the area. This encounter became physical as the National Guard troops struck the student and attempted to apprehend him. The student was able to escape from the troops and enter Taylor Hall. G Group and A Company continue toward Blanket Hill, firing tear gas as they move forward. The students continue to flee the area and keep their distance from the approaching troops. The television news media began following behind the line of the guardsmen, but stopped in the middle of the common. Students are seen throwing rocks at the approaching line of troops. Students that ran from the gas have now stopped at the top of Blanket Hill and look to see if they are still being followed. Terry Norman is spotted near the Johnson Hall parking lot taking photos of all that is happening. William McGuire is spotted on the Taylor Hall terrace taking photos of the approaching National Guard troops. William's photos show a student being stopped and questioned by the troops in the Johnson Hall parking lot. Chuck Ayers was in the parking lot and took this close-up of that interaction. William McGuire continues to take photos as the National Guard moves up Blanket Hill. Other than a few students in the Johnson Hall parking lot, the majority of students continue running from the approaching troops and tear gas. They move over Blanket Hill and around the pagoda.
So I'm going up the hill between Taylor Hall and Johnson Hall, and I had taken some photographs of Barry and Allison at the pagoda.
Howard can be seen taking the photo of Allison and Barry over these troops moving up the hill. The students continue to throw back tear gas canisters that have landed on top of Blanket Hill and around the pagoda. G Group and A Company continue up Blanket Hill. These troops move up the hill with no resistance other than a student or two throwing rocks. The students disperse in every direction. Very few students remain near the pagoda at the top of Blanket Hill. After moving between Taylor Hall and Johnson Hall, the troops spread out, moving students away from Johnson Hall. C Company takes a position between Taylor Hall and Prentice Hall to keep students from returning to the commons. G Group and A Company have reached the pagoda and cleared the area. It has been approximately 20 minutes since Officer Rice gave the first orders to disperse. This Chris Abel film shows a National Guard tear gas canister overshooting the top of Blanket Hill and landing just past the fence line on the practice field. Students can be seen moving away from the approaching troops. The students are fleeing towards Lake Hall, the gymnasium, the practice field, Prentice Hall, and the Prentice Hall parking lot. The troops are visible in the film moving between the trees. For some reason, General Canterbury makes the decision to have the troops follow a group of students heading towards the practice field. G Group and A Company troops pursue the students moving towards the fence line on the practice field. The students start to bunch up as they wait their turn to get through a small gate in the fence that is on three sides of the practice field. This group of students that stopped at the fence gate become the focus of the guardsmen. C Company holds its position and watches G Group and A Company move into the practice field. Hundreds of students have just rushed through the Prentice Hall parking lot out into Midway Road between Prentice Hall and Dunbar Hall. All of the students made their way through the gate opening once G Group and A Company arrive on the practice field. The troops can be seen standing around, their objective completed. The students are dispersed. They could easily return to the commons without further incident. Looking closely at this photo, you can see that General Canterbury is looking towards Midway Road between Prentice Hall and Dunbar Hall. This is where many students have stopped to see what will happen next. This crowd has caught the attention of Canterbury and others. Another strange event taking place is Terry Norman walking within the National Guard formation. No other student photographers are near the area.
When they got down to the open flat area, I thought, what are they doing? Because they walked into this area And it was like no one was telling them what to do. They were just walking. And they walked down to the flat area. And there was a chain link fence all the way around. And they walked into the area at the end of the chain link fence with nowhere to go.
The guard on the practice football field looked, they didn't look like a cohesive group of people. The people on when the guard got to the practice football field and found out that they couldn't go anywhere, they didn't look very cohesive. They didn't look very, they didn't look like they knew what they were doing. They got trapped and they didn't expect it. And the other thing was, how far did they think they were going to chase these students across campus? Because unlike a lot of campuses, Kent is huge.
With troops still awaiting orders and a fence to their front and on both sides, the only option is to return the way they came. But the troops are ordered to move down the fence line. Major Jones, concerned that the troops are stopped at the fence, decides to leave C Company and runs into the practice field to assist. Jones meets up with General Canterbury and is seen in this photo pointing to the location of C Company between Taylor Hall and Prentice Hall. Terry Norman is still seen walking around with the National Guard troops. The troops extend their line from the fence gate down to the backstop of a softball area on the practice field. There is a fence that separates the practice field from the Prentice Hall parking lot. Initially, the students run from the parking lot towards Midway Road and move away from the approaching troops. The students soon notice that troops cannot follow because the fence has stopped their movements. Some students begin to return to the parking lot. Some start throwing rocks. Students begin to move out onto the hill in front of Taylor Hall. The longer the troops remain on the practice field, the more curious the students become, returning to the area wondering what will happen next. This aerial photo helps with a better understanding of what is beginning to develop. Some of the students are moving back into the Prentice Hall parking lot from Midway Road, others starting to gather on the hill in front of Taylor Hall. The frustration of being on the practice field must have been growing with the troops. This photo captures what looks like a National Guardsman throwing a rock back towards the Prentice Hall parking lot and the students. Witnesses also say they saw and heard a pistol being fired by someone on the practice field. The FBI investigation would document this, and during the investigation found a spent shell casing on the practice field. The troops move back, creating distance from the Prentice Hall parking lot, and form an L-shaped formation.
There was some rock throwing and exchange of tear gas at that time from Prentice parking lot to the athletic field and back. The guard went through several skirmish line lineups of trying to get in a threatening position to the students.
More students are now in the Prentice Hall parking lot, with the National Guard stopped on the practice field and no longer following students. More students begin moving towards the campus, heading to different locations or just watching what is happening. In an attempt to intimidate and possibly get the students to move back, some of the troops take a knee and aim their rifles at the students in the parking lot. The troops fire tear gas at two growing groups, one in the Prentice Hall parking lot and others gathering on the hill near Taylor Hall. Students pick up the tear gas and throw it back at the troops, and more students begin throwing rocks towards the practice field. The FBI investigation documents that during this time frame, the most rocks were thrown at the National Guard by the students. This recording of a student yelling to the National Guard shows that they were getting bolder. Jeff Miller is seen in these photos. He is standing with a group of students near Midway Road. He then can be seen moving towards the Prentice Hall parking lot as other students move in that direction. And lastly, he can be seen throwing a tear gas canister towards the National Guard, who are about 50 to 60 yards from him.
So as I went down to the end of the walk there by the street, I was pretty far to the left of the practice football field, and I turned and took some pictures of the students on the street and some pictures of students in the parking lot, and one of the students had a prophetic sign that said, "Dead End."
The troops maintained their position on the practice field, but their frustration must have been building as they just waited for orders on what to do next. Several students move around the fence and enter the practice field, getting closer to the troops. Their actions seem to embolden more students to return to the area. Many witnesses talk about a meeting of the National Guard leaders on the practice field and what was discussed.
And then the strangest thing happened was, well, maybe not strange because you have to have a plan, so the leaders of the National Guard who were there, General Canterbury, Major Jones, one of the lieutenants, they all got together in a group and talked about things. And while they were doing that, another group of National Guard formed a semicircle of about five or six National Guard with their guns pointed toward the space between Prentice Hall and the area right across the street where the students were. And that's when Alan Canfora was waving a black anarchist flag at them, and they were directly pointing their weapons at him. And you could tell it was starting to get to be very, very threatening. It was not a comfortable time to be in either one of those places.
Many claim that this is when the decision to open fire on the students at the pagoda was made. There is no evidence, and no guardsman has ever come forward with information to support that claim. More than likely, the discussion was how to get back to the commons after being on the practice field for roughly 10 minutes and with limited tear gas left to disperse the growing crowd of students. Shortly after this gathering, the troops formed up to move back towards the commons. The time is approximately 12:18.
There was a lull in the action, and I decided that I had two still cameras with me. I had a movie camera in my trunk, so I decided I was going to try to sneak around behind the parking lot and get down in the parking lot and get my movie camera. But as I was doing this, I noticed that the sound of the crowd was getting louder and louder. My back was to the crowd, my back was to the guard. I was walking to the graduate student parking lot, which was across the street from the Prentice parking lot. And I thought to myself, gee, are these kids behind me? And I turned around and they weren't. They were just much louder because it looked like the guard was going back up the hill. And I think the kids were deciding that they had won a victory, and they were just like a sporting event, cheering and getting more boisterous. And I thought to myself, I wonder if the guard knows that the kids aren't behind them either. But I could see how they might think that they were being pursued, because the noise was noticeably louder as even though I was getting further away from the crowd.
As the National Guard began moving back up the hill towards the pagoda, some of the students began following. The noise level and cheers were getting louder and louder. The troops were moving without using tear gas, and some thought they may have used all they had. The students on the hill in front of Taylor Hall began moving from the area, clearing a path for the troops to move forward. Many students began heading for their next classes. Sandra Sandy Scheuer is seen walking towards her next class in the Prentice parking lot. The students clear a path for the troops to move back to the commons and then stand and watch, thinking that it was over. Others begin to follow the troops as they move back up the hill, taunting and throwing rocks from a distance.
And they started moving out of that area, and they moved up the hill. And the students followed them. Some of the students backed off, and I didn't see anybody get real close to them that I can remember. And then they moved up the hill.
At which point, for whatever reason, I left the hill, turned to my left, went up a set of steps, and positioned myself behind the first pylon of Taylor Hall. There, at the front of the facade of the building has several concrete pylons, and I was on the pylon closest to the end of the building. I was behind it.
The troops move up the hill. They keep their distance from the students standing near Taylor Hall. The students follow them, causing concern. A National Guardsman's statement to the FBI claims that he heard a sergeant tell the troops that if they rush us, shoot them. Another National Guardsman claims that as they were approaching the trees, a student stepped out from behind the tree and threw a piece of wood. It landed near his foot. As he continued moving up the hill, the same student went to pick up the wood again, and at this point, Major Jones stepped forward and yelled at the student. Student photographers were seen running close to the troops. Terry Norman is believed to be in this area and possibly throwing rocks at students.
Well, some of them were National Guardsmen who witnessed it. I think it was Sergeant Day, and there were also some students like Tom Masterson who claimed he positioned himself right in between the guardsmen and the students and threw half a dozen or a dozen rocks. Norman himself said he threw two or three, but why is this guy throwing rocks at students? Was he trying to provoke an incident? It's never really been answered.
From a distance, students continue to throw things at the moving troops, but the distance and trees keep most items from reaching the soldiers. The National Guardsmen can be seen almost to the pagoda. In this photo, Allison Krauss is seen watching the troops from the Prentice parking lot. Jeffrey Miller is seen in this photo walking in the practice field almost to the access road.
And I took a couple pictures, and then all of a sudden, when they got to the top of the hill, they turned around.
Some turned with intent. Some may not have turned with intent.
Greg Moore's photos show the troops at the pagoda. Some of the troops are looking back. Others are still moving forward. What is interesting with this photo is that one or two have already turned around, but as a group, they will continue to move forward. The troops will pass the corner of the Taylor Hall Terrace railing and down from the pagoda to the area where the dirt meets the grass. This William Frederick photo was taken just seconds before the shooting started. There are a few things to note in this photo. Some of the troops are still walking and have not turned around. Others are just starting to turn, and others are already moving towards the pagoda. What is key in this photo is the troops moving towards the pagoda and looking to the left of the photo. This is the area where just moments before, a student had been confronted after throwing wood at the troops. You can see that the students are in the area. Howard Ruffner's photo captures the moment just seconds before the firing takes place. Howard had his back towards the Prentice Hall parking lot, and the troops are looking and moving to his left. This National Guardsman is aiming towards Ruffner and the Prentice Hall parking lot, a very obvious difference to the others. Paul Topol's photo is taken at almost the same time as Howard's, and you can see that the troops are moving back up towards the pagoda, their backs towards Taylor Hall. The Chris Abell film shows the National Guard location and the students near Taylor Hall.
They turned around and they were there, and I can't tell you for how long. It wasn't very long. And that's when we heard the bullets, that we heard the guns being fired.
And I think with considerable accuracy that I was the closest person to the guard when they started firing. And in that split second when the firing began, I was standing outside of the pylon. And it took me, gosh, a split second to realize maybe they are firing real weapons. I heard no order, common talk between the guard. My observation was they just turned and began firing.
On the way back when they turned and fired, I was 80 feet behind the guard. I was falling up the hill, and I just decided to get down because it was time, I looked like a person with a weapon on my chest with a long lens. And, when I got down, I thought, they're shooting over our heads. I mean, this is a typical kind of thing you see it on TV, shoot over their heads or shoot blanks or whatever. But then you hear, oh my God, they're shooting real bullets. Get down, stay down, they're shooting real bullets. There's a person bleeding over here. That's when it got real, very scary.
John Darnell's photo captures the first seconds of the National Guard opening fire on the students. Just a few students are moving up the hill towards the troops. The sudden reaction of the students turning and running signals the worst possible outcome of the protest. Look closely in these locations. Slowing the film down to show each frame, you can see what appears to be dirt and dust flying into the air from bullets hitting the ground. The same dirt and dust can be seen being kicked up in this Paul Topple photo as bullets are hitting the ground. The firing has started and people are reacting. Joe Lewis is standing, facing the troops. Howard Ruffner is starting to kneel down near the railing. A student is watching another student further away running from the gunfire. Watch the Chrisabelle film again for the dirt and dust in the air. From this aerial photo, the first bullets fired are hitting in this area. This is the area where just then a minute earlier, a student had thrown a piece of wood at one of the soldiers and Major Jones. It is believed that Terry Norman was somewhere in this general area when the shooting started. What most people do not remember is that James Russell was wounded by shots fired by the National Guard while he was in this area. Why would the National Guard troops need to move back on top of the hill by the pagoda? That's because it slopes down on the other side of the pagoda and anyone in that area would be hidden from their view. In this photo taken just days after, you can see how the ground slopes down. The dirt and dust seen in the Chrisabelle film would be just to the left of the light pole. This modern video shows how anybody on the opposite side of the pagoda would not be visible until you walked up the hill. The dust and bullet strikes from the first shots fired were near the light pole and display sign. In this modern photo from the corner of Taylor Hall, it is a clear view of the Prentice Hall parking lot and would not require the troops to get to a higher elevation.
As I got to my car, I put my keys in the trunk, popped the lid, dropped the Nikons in the trunk, opened the case to the movie camera, flipped open the handle, and I heard the shots. And I could, I thought, well, they're shooting over their heads, and I could actually hear bzzz, 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 going over my head. And I thought, whoa, that's pretty. I never saw the police or anybody doing that for just a student demonstration. But I turned around, pulled the trigger of the camera, and through the viewfinder, I saw the kids running toward my camera and hitting the ground. I'm assuming they are shot at the time, but it was kind of a disconnect that they would actually be shot. I mean, they were probably shooting over their heads and they were just diving for cover. Well, it was the opposite of that.
What is interesting in this film and supports the idea of the National Guard firing over the hill is that the students are running and taking cover. Firing has been going on for a few seconds and Joe Lewis and John Clary are still standing. This film frame shows the students laying on the ground between the pine trees in front of Taylor Hall and the access road. The National Guard troops can be seen near the pagoda. This is the area of the students in the Ling film. Most viewers focus on all the students in front of Taylor Hall, but just as the shooting stops, notice that there is a tear gas canister fired on the left of the screen. This is roughly the area where the student threw wood at a soldier and Major Jones, also possibly the area Terry Norman was spotted throwing rocks at students. James Russell was wounded by firing National Guard troops in this general area. What is happening here that is getting the troops' attention? Why did the troops suddenly use tear gas when they hadn't fired any since they were on the practice field? Focusing on the troops' actions during the shooting, just as the troops pass the pagoda, Major Jones and General Canterbury appear to be shocked that the troops have opened fire. You can see other troops seem to be surprised and looking to see what is happening. Many of the troops gave statements that they heard no command to fire, but rather reacted to the action of the other troops, believing that there was a command to fire. The idea of the troops reacting to others is clear in this photo, as only a few have turned and the others are still moving forward. These sudden changes by a few would immediately be replicated by the others. A guardsman did state that he yelled to fire over their heads. The meaning was not to shoot into the group of students, but over their heads once the firing had begun. Jones and Canterbury moved towards the firing troops and can be seen physically grabbing and forcefully pushing the troops to stop firing. Another claim is that the troops kneeled and fired, but no photo has ever shown troops kneeling in unison. But the photos do show some of the troops crouching slightly. Take a look at this person with a .45 handgun. We can see in this photo that the handgun is in the ready position with the slide forward. Just a few seconds later, the slide is in the locked back position, possibly from being fired. This Beverly Knowles Berger photo is incredible with all that is happening. The shooting has just stopped. The troops are just standing at the pagoda watching. Tear gas is blowing in the wind. Students are getting up and running away. The students that were wounded or killed in this photo are Joseph Lewis, John Cleary, Thomas Grace, Alan Canfora, Jeffrey Miller, Dean Kaler, Douglas Rentmore, Allison Krauss, William Schroeder, Sandy Scheuer.
And it was dead silent, almost. It was still very, and then it was a split second of me seeing just, there were people still running, but people were hunkered down, and it was very quiet. I heard some things. And I could hear a few people screaming, but it was sort of quiet. And then all of a sudden, it crescendoed. You could hear people screaming. They were yelling for help. They were asking for medical care. They were saying, help.
But right after that firing, that was silence. And that was followed by a realization by many people that kids were shot and some were dead. And it was... That's something you don't want to remember too much of. It's scary.
After the shooting stopped, many students rushed to help others that were injured. Others think that the National Guard may open fire again and run for cover. The troops remain at the pagoda. They don't offer to help the wounded, even though Joe Lewis is just about 35 yards from them. After roughly 3 minutes, Jones and Canterbury regain control and order the troops back to the area around the burnt ROTC building. Some witnesses say they heard some of the troops distraught with what had just happened. The troops continue to the ROTC building where they regroup and begin a weapons inspection. The students begin to help the injured. Now that the National Guard troops are no longer in the area, many students start to return to help. The shock of what has just happened is overwhelming to some. Others are angry at what has just happened. The crowd of students continues to grow as students now exit the surrounding buildings. Looking into the Prentice Hall parking lot, you can see that troops from C Company have moved into the parking lot to see what is happening, since their position between Taylor Hall and Prentice Hall kept them from seeing what had just taken place. When they get to Jeffrey Miller's body, they are greeted with very angry students and leave, returning to the ROTC area. Professor Glenn Frank is seen running in the commons to an ambulance parked near National Guard troops at the ROTC area. He quickly gets in and races towards Taylor Hall. They stop the ambulance near the wounded student, Joseph Lewis. During this time, Terry Norman is photographed kneeling next to a student that appears injured. This location is very near the location where the students threw wood at a soldier and Major Jones while the troops were moving towards the pagoda. It is also the area where it is believed that Terry Norman was throwing rocks at students. It has long been believed that the Terry Norman incident with other students possibly occurred before the National Guard opened fire, and that his actions of having a gun and firing it caused the troops to open fire. This photograph was taken after the shooting and just before students attempted to take his camera, believing he was taking photos for the police. During the altercation to get his camera, Terry Norman pulls out a handgun and threatens the students as he begins to run away. He is spotted by a graduate student, Harold Reed, and chased all the way to the National Guard lines near ROTC. Terry Norman hands over the gun and his ID to the police and troops. Harold Reed is interviewed by the police. To validate the timing in this photo, you can see the ambulance parked at the National Guard lines. It is not there in any news footage or photos taken when Terry Norman gets to the National Guard troops. This photo shows that Harold Reed was taking cover near Jeffrey Miller by the access road during the shooting. One other photo, not in this documentary, shows Harold Reed immediately following the shooting, walking up towards the pagoda on the sidewalk.
Well, Reed told me that he witnessed Norman standing over a student on the ground, and he believed, he got the impression that Norman had just shot the student. So Reed started giving chase, so did Bill Barrett, the head of the Alumni Association and Alumni Magazine, and they chased him from that area close to the pagoda all the way back to the garden lines at the other end of the commons. I don't know of one eyewitness who actually can say that he saw Norman fire that gun.
In the Prentice Hall parking lot, students gather around to help in any way they can. William Schroeder. Allison Krauss. Jeffrey Miller. Sandy Shoyer was picked up by the students and moved from the parking lot to the grass at the corner of Prentice Hall. She has major injuries to her neck and throat. Students attempt to stop the bleeding and begin mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Sandy never regains consciousness after being shot and dies as fellow students try to help. William Schroeder is not far from Sandy and being helped by fellow students. The ambulance is parked near Joseph Lewis, and other students are helping John Cleary. A stretcher is being brought to Allison Krauss. Joseph Lewis was the closest wounded student to the National Guard at about 75 feet. He is shot in the lower left abdomen, the bullet exiting his left buttock, and shot a second time with the bullet going through his lower left leg. Seeing the ambulance stop near Taylor Hall, students carry William Schroeder from the Prentice Hall parking lot to the ambulance. Students carrying Allison Krauss also move towards Taylor Hall. Professor Glenn Frank is seen moving down the sidewalk. William Schroeder waits to be loaded into the ambulance. He was shot while laying face down on the left side of his lower back. The bullet exited his left shoulder. William Schroeder dies during surgery at the hospital. Professor Frank directs the students carrying Allison Krauss. They seem to realize that the ambulance is fully loaded. Professor Frank seems to be telling them to go back. Jeffrey Miller is still laying on the access road. A bullet has entered his mouth and exited the back of his head. He is killed instantly. Dean Kaler is not far from Miller. He has been shot in the lower back and will be permanently paralyzed from the waist down. Allison Krauss has moved very near Jeff Miller and waits for another ambulance. A bullet has hit Allison in the upper left arm, shattering the bones, with bullet fragments entering her left chest, causing major internal injuries. She waits on a stretcher, struggling to breathe, Barry Levine attempting to comfort her. One of the first ambulances on the scene is loaded and heads to the hospital. Students try to give comfort to Jeffrey Miller by attempting to stop the bleeding of his head injury. What they do not realize is that he was killed instantly. More ambulances are arriving. Many of the wounded have been moved by fellow students to other locations like the Prentice Hall lobby for care, and others wait for the next ambulances to arrive. An ambulance crew arrives and places Jeffrey Miller's body on a stretcher. Allison Krauss waits. Another crew arrives and Allison is taken to a waiting ambulance on Midway Road. Barry Levine continues to comfort her. She dies shortly after arriving at the hospital from her injuries. After roughly 20 minutes since the shooting stopped, all of the killed and wounded students are now being taken to local hospitals.
It was mainly a time of confusion. There were some people having tantrums. There was this Thomas fellow who was dipping a flag in Jeffrey Miller, turned out to be Jeffrey Miller's blood, and wanting to share the, get the blood on the sacrificed on the people close enough to be sprayed by it. So I'm sure a lot of people went home with Jeffrey Miller's blood on their clothes. He was panicked, you know. He was in his just acting out, having a tantrum, and I don't blame him. Other people were I remember one guy was leaning on a car and he had some sort of saying on the back of his jacket. Pigs go home, I'm not sure, something like that. But, you know, he was crying. But most people were just milling around wondering what's going to happen next. Nobody paid any attention to me or my cameras. In fact, I stood in the middle of the crowd and did a 360 you could see everybody just looking at me like, okay, no big deal. I was kind of new at the movie game. I was shooting it more like stills, a burst of this, a pop of that. I only had, you know, 6 or 7 minutes of film available to me, so I wasn't trying to, you know, shoot a documentary or anything. I didn't know whether anybody would even look at this. I thought maybe that it would be on TV or something if I could get it there. But there was no animosity and no blowback for any of the photographers that I noticed.
Shock and anger overcomes some students. Many of the students were gathering near the pagoda. The crowd was growing and they wanted answers. They believed their answers would come from the leadership of the National Guard and begin moving back down into the commons. The crowd grows very quickly and students appear from all directions. Some angry students want to charge the National Guard troops. Others just want to sit and protest. Others want to know who is to be held responsible.
Let's sit for a moment in silence. Then, for heaven's sakes, let's get up and slowly and in a reasonable way march off of here, away from those men with the guns.
No! No!
Kids, they've got ammunition in it.
Martin Luther King was a man who understood that to win you must live. If you die, you cannot win anything.
With the students now filling the commons, the troops begin to surround them. Professor Frank meets with Major Jones. Franks is told to clear the commons or the troops would clear the area.
Hold on. Please listen to me right now.
Wait a minute.
I don't care whether you've never listened to anyone before in your lives. I am begging you right now. If you don't disperse right now, they're going to move in, and it can only be a slaughter. Would you please listen to me? Jesus Christ, I don't want to be a part of this.
Please.
I'm begging you also, follow me out this way. Follow me.
The troops are now moving into the commons, and the time is 1:30.
Professor Glenn Frank's pleas to the students to leave the area finally began to settle the students down. Many started to exit from the commons in the only direction the National Guard allowed. Other students gathered near Taylor Hall. The Kent State campus was officially closed and all students were told to immediately leave the area. To help with the tension growing on campus, the Ohio State Police moved forward to disperse the crowd with the National Guard following. The Kent State campus would remain closed for the next 6 weeks. Numerous investigations would be conducted along with court cases. The Scranton Commission would conduct an investigation on campus unrest and concluded that the shootings at Kent State were unnecessary, unwarranted, inexcusable, and unjustified. Criminal court cases were dismissed and civil trials continued for many years. The civil trials finally concluded in 1979 when the victims of the tragedy accepted a settlement of $675,000 to be divided between the wounded victims and the families of those killed, and a letter of remorse from the Ohio National Guard. What truly happened will more than likely never be fully discovered, but we have developed a better understanding from reviewing the photos, films, and witness statements. Political rhetoric and a culture that looked down on protesters made for hostilities. The Ohio National Guard had been working at a trucker's strike and was transferred to Kent. These troops were almost on continuous duty since arriving on campus and lacking sleep. More than likely, several were hostile to the protesters, and once they were stopped on the practice field, their hostility boiled over. When the opportunity was presented, two or three took action, and the rest of the troops, suddenly startled by the sound of gunfire, reacted, believing they were ordered to fire. Firing on unarmed protesting college students, unnecessary, unwarranted, inexcusable, and unjustified. The students killed by the Ohio National Guard gunfire on May 4, 1970. Jeffrey Miller, Allison Krauss, William Schroeder, Sandra Scholier. The students wounded by the Ohio National Guard gunfire on May 4, 1970. Joseph Lewis, John Cleary, Thomas Grace, Alan Canfora, Dean Kaler, Douglas Rentmore, James Russell, Robert Stamps, Donald McKenzie. Today, Kent State has an enrollment of over 40,000 students with excellent academic leadership. Since May 4, 1971, family, students, faculty, and special guests have participated in memorial anniversary services to honor those killed and wounded. Kent State and the May 4th Task Force have taken great strides in developing interpretive displays, markers, and memorials. The May 4th Visitor Center is filled with displays and artifacts and should be your first stop for a better understanding of the events on May 4th, 1970. As you walk the area, there are several informational displays that point out what happened on that tragic day. In the Prentice Hall parking lot, memorials mark the location of the four slain students, and brass markers have been placed at the location of each of the wounded students. As you follow these markers, it gives you a much deeper understanding of the events. The memorial and its engraving, Inquire, Learn, and Reflect, offers an area to take in all that has happened on May 4, 1970. We must remember our history, or we are doomed to repeat it.
It took me a while to speak about Kent State to anyone, and it took me a number of years to talk about it without crying, because it was a very traumatic event where you saw people lose their lives, and you saw our nation changing in different ways that was not healthy. And I had a brother still serving in Vietnam, and I was very thankful that he came home.
To me, Kent State, the message of Kent State, the best thing you can get out of this tragedy is that people should live in peace and harmony and with love for one another. If you get some other message out of Kent State, you're screwy. You should take the good and carry that in your heart and let it ride. And our world would be better off if we were all like that.
I think probably Kent could be doing a little bit more to educate the current group of students on the history of the tragedy. Friends of mine have told me that they visited campus and have gotten conversation with students, and they know almost nothing about what happened in 1970.
Kent State is remembered as best it can be, and the most important part about what's happened, I think, has been for Kent State to stop ignoring the fact that something happened there that caused a humongous change in our schooling, our system, our National Guard, everything, and accept that, because I think for a long time they didn't want to accept that responsibility of having the change on this small Midwestern college.
To me, it was one of the gravest injustices of the 20th century in modern American history. It morphed into one of the greatest injustices. And I think that's how Kent State should be remembered.
The idea of bestowing an honorary degree on the Forest Lane students certainly is a noble idea. It costs the university nothing. It shows great symbolism. I think possibly with those degrees, there should maybe be a scholarship fund in each of their names to help a student who may not be able to attend otherwise, and would be a fitting thing to do, something like that. So anything that could be done in their name couldn't hurt.
The photographers that took the photos and films on May 4th, 1970 documented history for future generations to research and gain a better understanding. Without their actions, we would miss an opportunity to get the facts. If you have photos or films of the events of May 1st through May 4th, 1970, please consider contacting the Kent State Library Special Collections and Archive so that future generations will have the opportunity to conduct research and have a better understanding of May 4th, 1970.